Welcome to the grave marker dedication service for Colonel David Dyer. It took place Saturday, May 25th, 2019 at 2 p.m. at the Dyer-Bibee Cemetery. Special thank you to Horn Funeral Service and Crematory, 1300 North Franklin Street, Christiansburg, Virginia, and DeVilbiss Funeral Home, 1200 Grove Avenue, Radford, Virginia, and all the many other people like the Star Tribune, and a special thank you to everyone that's listed in the program.
Hi, I'm Darlene Foster with H.A. Carrington, 1055 UDC. We are here to honor this veteran, Mr. Dyer, on this Memorial Day weekend.
Hello, I'm Connie Blanks, and I'm here because my husband is participating in the service today, and he is with the Campbell Guards, Sons of Confederate Veterans.
Hi, my name is Bill Ray. I'm here to honor our Confederate ancestors, veterans, and all military veterans on this Memorial Day weekend.
I'm Bill Cruz. I'm the 7th Brigade Commander, Sons of Confederate Veterans. Mr. Alex called me way back there and started getting some of this together, and so I just been supporting it as it come along. And whenever I have an opportunity, I like to come out and pay homage to the honorable service of our ancestors here in the Commonwealth of Virginia.
This is David Moore. I'm a member of the Charlotte County Grays, Sons of Confederate Veterans, and we do a lot of flag work and rifle salutes for people that are having memorial services or remembrance or dedications of stones in cemeteries and stuff, things like that for our Confederate ancestors.
But yeah, she's on my dad's side, on the Hale side. She's also one of her grandfathers is a Confederate, and she's like, her grandfather's actually buried right beside my grandfather, and they were brothers. So, and we've been doing this for a little while. I'm not really sure what to say.
That's fine. Go ahead.
I'm Carolyn Steinbeck. This is because she helped me find my Hale Cemetery up in Farum.
Yep, Farum, Franklin County. Moonshine Capital.
So,
yeah.
Anyway, I'm with the Anne Eliza Johns, UDC.
Okay.
And I'm with H.A. Carrington.
Kim Chandler. I'm a 4th great granddaughter.
Yeah.
Am I? Thank you.
No, you're the 3rd.
I'm the 3rd.
Okay.
Oh, that's right, Travis.
And I'm the 2nd great granddaughter.
Alex Davis's dad, he's the one that's ramrodding this event.
And I'm Pam Davis, his mom, and I'm the 3rd great granddaughter.
I'm Ricky Pritchett, representing Pennsylvania Vindicators Camp 828, and I'll be placing a flag and a wreath for the ceremony today.
I'm Diane McMahon, and I'm here for the Anne Eliza Johns UDC, and I'll be placing the wreath for my UDC.
My name's Kyle Griffith, and I'm here for the same SCV group, and then I'm also here just to appreciate any Confederate veterans that are want to be appreciated.
I am Chaplain Richard Daniel from the Virginia State Mechanized, as well as from the NB Pont campus is my wife Tracy, and we are here today to honor a soldier, both U.S. and Confederate, and to share a little bit about the great revival that took place during the Southern Army during the late war between the states, and the effect it had on our society even leading up till today. Very honored and privileged to be here.
Go ahead.
Today we're here to render military honors for a Civil War veteran. We were invited down here by DeVilbiss Funeral Home. Alex asked us to come down, and we're glad to be here today to give this man his military rights.
Specialist Queens.
Hi, Sergeant Thurman. We're here today to do military honors for this veteran.
We are honored to come up here today and help with this dedication ceremony to one of our fallen Confederate heroes from the past.
I'm a member of the Sons of Confederate Veterans, and we are very honored to do this today because so much is being lost. that we need to keep alive. We're a heritage organization that honor our Confederate veterans.
Also very honored and privileged to be here, especially since he was an American soldier as well as a Confederate soldier, and that both are being represented today is outstanding. We represent the Charlotte County Grays in Charlotte County, Virginia, and we are privileged to be here.
Larry Hartso, Sons of Confederate Veterans Camp, Charlotte County Grays, here to honor a Confederate soldier.
Fantastic. Tell me a little bit about this.
Cap pouch, which ignites the powder.
Okay.
Scabbard for the bayonet. And that's about it.
Ladies and gentlemen, right on. Thank you so very much for braving this ridiculously cold and snowy weather to to come out and be with us today as we honor the life and legacy, if you will, of David Dyer. Who just happens to be my fourth great-grandfather. We're happy you guys, like I said, were able to make it out here. We've got a number of presentations, a wonderful keynote speaker, and we hope this afternoon will be a wonderful one for you to honor and remember a man such as he. So without further ado, we will now welcome to the mic, if you will, Chaplain Richard Daniels for the invocation.
Thank you, Brother Alex. God bless all y'all. I'm Southern Baptist, so I'm a little bit loud talkative, so I'm going to move right down here with you. And we're going to talk for just a minute. We'll open up with a prayer. As he touched on, we're here to honor the memory of a soldier. It's a fitting day for that, Memorial Day weekend, for us to come out and pay respects and pay honor to this soldier. I will say something briefly about Mr. Dyer, Brother Dyer there. The winter of 1862-63, a religious movement occurred in the Southern armies that would be known as the Great Revival of the Southern armies down through history. He would have certainly witnessed that and encouraged that amongst the young soldiers as they found their way to God. It was truly an awe-inspiring time. True revival has not happened often throughout history, but this was a true revival that would have long-lasting effects on these men, their families, and this entire region as we became known as the Bible Belt. So we honor him today, and we honor the Lord above everything. God bless y'all. Let us open with a prayer. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Father, we thank you for this day. We thank you for giving us beautiful weather to be out here together, Father, to honor a soldier, Father, who served valiantly and bravely during his time. Father, we thank you for his life. We thank you for the lives that he touched, as well as the soldiers that served in his command touch. Father, please bless this event. Please help us to conduct this event in a way that will be pleasing in your eyes. And it's in Jesus' name we pray, and all of God's children said, Amen. Amen.
So I know I was just up here welcoming you all unofficially to this event. I'd now like to go ahead and officially welcome you to this event. And in doing so, I have a letter that I would like to read for you. This letter is written to those gathered here in Gretna by a gentleman named Robert McIver. Robert McIver is the president of the entire Descendants of Mexican War Veterans Society. He is in Texas, so for obvious reasons, he wasn't able to get out here on such short notice, but I will read what he is saying to you all from Texas. Ladies and gentlemen, good afternoon. Since I personally could not be with you here in Virginia, I wish to take this opportunity to say a few words through this letter. I would like to say welcome to everyone who came out today to honor the life and military service of David Dyer, who served faithfully as a veteran in the Mexican War and in the American Civil War. To give you a short background, I would like to tell you about young David Dyer and the reason why he joined the men of the United States in 1846 who wished to serve their country and protect our freedom. In December 1845, the Republic of Texas voted to join the United States. It was on February 2nd, 1846, that Texas officially joined the United States of America. On April 24th, 1846, General Mariano Arista of Mexico directed approximately 2,000 Mexican troops to cross the Rio Grande River. One day later, about 25 miles northwest of present-day Brownsville, Texas, the Mexican troops ambushed a squad of United States Dragoons led by Captain Seth Thornton. During the skirmish which followed, the patrol lost 14 men, with the remainder being taken prisoner. Two wounded Americans later died. General Zachary Taylor immediately sent a report about the ambush to President James K. Polk. It was received in Washington 2 weeks later. After consulting with his cabinet that Sunday, President Polk proclaimed that American blood has been shed upon American soil. He called for an immediate declaration of war, and Congress, wasting no time, made it official on May 13th, 1846. In the meantime, two major battles occurred. On May 8th, 1846, the Mexican army began their attack on Palo Alto, and one day later, the Battle of Resaca de la Palma took place. This was the beginning of a two-year war with Mexico. A call went out for President Polk requesting every state in the Union to send all able-bodied volunteers for 12-month service to help General Zachary Taylor along the border. David Dyer, then a young man, accepted that call to serve his country by volunteering for duty. He knew America's freedom was at risk, and it would take all Americans to stand up and fight. His muster roll reveals that he joined as a private on May 25th, 1846, and mustered in for duty at a camp near Austin, Texas, joining in Captain Samuel Highsmith's Company K of Young's 3rd Regiment of the Texas Mounted Volunteers. He served in this company until September 1846. Several other men in Highsmith's company re-enlisted with Private David Dyer for a second tour of duty at a camp near San Marcos. In Henry E. McCulloch's company of Smith's Battalion on October 22nd, 1846, and he served for 12 months until October 21st, 1847. Since Dyer's duty was over, he could, like many soldiers, have gone home. However, he chose at this time to re-enlist again on October 25th, 1847 in Bell's regiment. He was discharged at McCulloch Station 12 months later. The Treaty of Peace between the United States and Mexico was signed at Guadalupe Hidalgo on February 2nd, 1848. The American Army evacuated Mexico in June of 1848. When the war was officially over, the Rio Grande River was declared the official international boundary between the United States and Mexico. Even though the war had now ended, several companies commanded by Peter Harnsborough Bell were left on the frontier of Texas until their service ended. Private Dyer was honorably discharged to go home with this group on October 24th, 1848. He served faithfully throughout the 2 years of the Mexican War. In 1887, Dyer, a man now in his 60s, applied to the United States government and was granted a Mexican War Survivor's Pension of $8. All soldiers who fought to keep the United States a free country should always and forever be honored and remembered for their military service. As the president of the Descendants of Mexican War Veterans, it is my privilege and honor to dedicate this grave marker of David Dyer for his service as a veteran in the war with Mexico of 1846.
Thank you all for coming today. This is even more, I think, than Alex and I imagined when we started planning this. We just wanted to make sure we had a marker for our ancestor, David Dyer. So thank you all for being here. I want to quickly ask descendants of Colonel Dyer to stand, and I'm going to do so by starting with his children's families. So everyone here from Texana Dyer Williams family please stand or wave your hand? Mary Sue, that's you. Okay. And by the way, I did some, I did a family tree this week, and it was very hurriedly done. And so I know a lot of information is missing, but I'd be more than happy. I made 25 copies. I'd be more than happy for you to take one and let me know where I've left things off. After Texana, a baby was born who died, and he wasn't even named. The next child was Douglas Dyer, who married Alice Cornelia Williams. And for those of us in the Williams family, she's connected to us as well. This happens a lot in Pittsylvania County. So all of those from the Douglas Dyer family, if anyone's here from the Douglas Dyer family? Yes, wonderful. The next one is Samuel Wise Dyer, and the best that we can tell, there are no living descendants of Samuel Wise Dyer. No, I take that back. I'm getting mixed up with David Whittle. There is one woman who lives in Newport News who's a direct descendant, and she has children and grandchildren. We were not able to contact her in time for her to make a decision whether she could come or not. So there is one. David Whittle Dyer is the one that, the best we can tell, there are no living descendants. But a lot of you will recognize that middle name Whittle because that's a big name in the Gretna area. The next one was Mary Elizabeth Lizzie Dyer. And she married but had no children. Then there was Ida Verinda Dyer, the baby. And I know we have descendants from Ida Dyer who married Mr. Bass, Henry Bass, Henry Stadler Bass. So please raise your hand or stand if you're from there. The next thing that I want to do is introduce our speaker, and there is information about him in your program, and I don't want to go into a lot of links, but somehow or another, Mr. Brandau, who has a career in the science, has written books about history, and we love that. And as a history major myself, I love history. Mr. Brandau, I'm honored to have you come and speak to us, and I'm gonna leave my remarks to that because people don't wanna hear me talk about you, they wanna hear you talk.
Thank you for that great introduction. Ladies, gentlemen, and descendants of Colonel David Dyer, it is my profound honor to speak as we dedicate his headstone. Colonel Dyer was truly a lion of the den, as my new book portrays him and other Southside Virginia soldiers. The geography of this region is more appropriately North Carolina than Virginia. In colonial times, the Roanoke River watershed, including tributaries like the Dan River, isolated the region from the Chesapeake Bay economy. Those who settled here were mostly religious dissenters and outcasts from the Virginia colony. These were fiercely independent people, as are their descendants who live here today. The tobacco rolling road, which is now Route 29, which most of you traveled getting here, provided James River access at Lynchburg. After the Revolutionary War, the Dismal Swamp Canal opened water transport on the Dan River to Norfolk. In 1859, the Richmond-Danville Railroad truly opened the county to trade. Danville and Pennsylvania County were just beginning to thrive when the secession crisis rose. Pennsylvanians and most of Virginia remained pro-Union until Abraham Lincoln called for Virginia troops to subjugate the seceded states. Virginia then quit the Union and aligned itself with the Confederacy. Established militia units formed regiments. Three companies from Danville, Pennsylvania County were in the 18th Virginia. two were in the 21st Virginia, and seven companies dominated the 38th Virginia, known as the Pennsylvania Regiment. But as Northern invasion became imminent, more Pennsylvanians rallied to defend their homes. This is where David Dyer comes into the picture. Pennsylvania County was not a land of cotton. People here grew tobacco. We carefully note that David Dyer was no slave owner, and neither were his neighbors. In the 1860 census, one has to look beyond his nearest 50 neighbors to find a slave owner. Dyer was a Mexican War veteran who recruited a company in this vicinity, then known as Galveston. When Elijah Keene of Dry Fork organized a battalion, David Dyer's company, the Galveston Tigers, became Company A in Keene's battalion. The first major battle had already been fought when Keene's battalion arrived in Richmond for training in August. Keene's battalion and five companies from other counties formed the 57th Virginia Infantry. Captain David Dyer's company then became Company D. The men had only civilian clothing, no weapons, and Major Keene had little, if any, military training. The War Department assigned former U.S. Army officers Lewis A. Armistead and George W. Carr as Colonel and Lieutenant Colonel, respectively. The two professional soldiers whipped the unit into a proper regiment. Once outfitted and trained, the 57th Virginia posted briefly in Richmond. In February 1862, New Bern and other towns on the North Carolina coast fell into Union hands. The Army rushed Armistead's 57th Virginia to the Virginia-North Carolina border to build a fort. Within weeks, the Confederate Army promoted Lewis Armistead to Brigadier General. Once part of Armistead's brigade, the 57th Virginia reorganized and voted out Colonel Carr. They elected Elisha Keene as Colonel, Waddy James as Lieutenant Colonel, and David Dyer as Major. When the Union Army advanced up the peninsula, the Confederates abandoned Norfolk, surrounding areas, and retreated to Richmond. General Armistead detached the 57th Virginia to reinforce Drury's Bluff. Thus, they missed the Battle of Seven Pines. However, after returning with Armistead's brigade, the 57th Virginia fought in the Battle of Malvern Hill. Six times, their brigade charged mass Union artillery supported by infantry. However, on their second charge, a volley into the 57th Virginia devastated the ranks, killed two captains, and wounded the color bearer. Thus shocked, the 57th Virginia broke. Their stampede not only carried away the 9th Virginia, but General Armistead as well. While the remaining three regiments of Armistead's brigade fought on. To their credit, the 57th Virginia had sustained the highest number of casualties of any regiment in Armistead's brigade that day. Although his men had fought like lions, General Armistead's personal reputation suffered so severely at Malvern Hill that General Lee posted Armistead at the end of his army on every march thereafter. At Second Manassas, Armistead's brigade was Lee's only unengaged brigade. At Sharpsburg, Armistead's brigade was sent into action only after Armistead had become disabled. At Fredericksburg, Armistead's brigade sat idle. Gettysburg, being the last in line, allowed Armistead's brigade to reach the stone wall atop Cemetery Ridge. There, post-war art and legend elevated Louis Armistead to an icon of Southern heroism. Popular history jealously protects this latter image of Armistead. To do so, it must ignore Armistead's past and the better record of better men in his command. Armistead was, in fact, the black sheep of Lee's lieutenants. He was a two-time West Point failure who resigned to avoid expulsion for a famous fit of anger in which he broke a plate over a classmate's head. Anyone else's military career would have ended then and there, but Armistead secured an officer's commission through his father, who happened to be the Major General in overall command of U.S. troops in the Second Seminole War. By January 1863, Armistead's mediocre leadership forced Colonel David Dyer to resign. In this, we find Colonel Dyer in exceptionally good company. For popular colonels who acted in the best interest of their men were targets for Armistead's displeasure. Armistead behaviors alienated every galvanized civilian who served as colonel under him. Dyer became colonel of the 57th Virginia after Elijah Keene and Waddy James resigned after Malvern Hill. In the months before Gettysburg, Dyer was just one of four more colonels to resign. Colonel Tomlin of the 53rd Virginia resigned. Tomlin was a former member of the Virginia General Assembly. His battalion was the one that grew into the 53rd Virginia. Tomlin's successor, Colonel Grammer, a physician in civilian life, served 2 months and then resigned. Colonel Gilliam, 9th Virginia, another physician in civilian life, resigned. All resigned on account of Louis Armistead. At Gettysburg, the men of Armistead's brigade fought gallantly. Their heroism in Pickett's charge is legendary. Armistead was killed, but his brigade remained intact and fought bravely throughout the rest of the war. In his time with the 57th Virginia, Colonel David Dyer served with the distinction and under difficult circumstances. Respect for the man is evident. His peers voted him captain, and then they voted him major. General Armistead personally promoted Dyer to colonel of his very own old regiment. But differences in leadership style drew unfair censure. After resigning, David Dyer returned home, having faithfully served. It is fitting we mark his final resting place and remember him as a citizen soldier, a field grade officer, and a Lion of the Dan. We note that his Civil War service represents less than 2% of his long and colorful life. The eternal measure of a man is his faith, hope, and charity shared with family, friends, and comrades. In this, we delight to honor Colonel David Dyer, knowing that all glory belongs to God. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much. That was wonderful. At this point, we are moving into the portion of the cemetery where, we're already in this portion of the cemetery. We're in this portion of the ceremony where the Confederate grave marking ritual and dedication is getting ready to begin. If I can ask Ms. Jennings to come forward, and we will now enter into this portion, and it's a very lovely and touching one, I might add.
My name is Sharon Jennings, and this is Diane Barbara, and we're members of the Anne Eliza Johns Chapter in Danville, Virginia. We've been a chapter for 122 years, and we're still active, and we're honored to be here today to do this. Nothing is ended until it is forgotten. That which is held in memory still endures and is real. We are grateful for the records of the past, which bring inspiration and courage. We are appreciative of the lessons taught by memorials to events and deeds of long ago. We pray that our lives may always be patterned to give such devotion and service as did our forefathers of this great Southland. We, the members of the Anne Eliza Johns Chapter, United Daughters of the Confederacy, now dedicate this Iron Cross in grateful recognition of the noble service of Colonel David Dyer, a Confederate soldier. May this cross be blessed. May it remind all who pause not only of the noble deeds of this Confederate veteran, but of the continuing need for unselfish service. From this moment of dedication, we trust there may come inspiration for broader vision and finer service.
Not for fame or fortune, not for place or rank, not lured by ambition or goaded by necessity, but in simple obedience to duty as they understood it. These men suffered all, sacrificed all, dared all, and died. And now the descendants of Colonel Dyer, Alex Davis, will come up and unveil the Iron Cross.
On the marker reads, David Dyer, Company K, 3rd Texas Mounted Volunteers, service in the Mexican War, and Colonel of the 57th Virginia Infantry of the Confederate States of America, born December 28, 1822, died May the 5th, 1899. Just briefly, just wanted to say, because it is so hot, if anyone does need water, right behind the very last row in the white tent is a cooler that's absolutely filled with cool water. And there's another one, a blue cooler, that's right behind that set of chairs near the camo sack chair. So they've got water available for you too as well. And with that being said, as a representative for and a member of the Descendants of Mexican War Veterans, I'd like to now dedicate this Mexican War bronze laurel marker in honor of David Dyer for his patriotic and loyal service in the United States Army during the Mexican War of 1846 to 1848. Now we will move forward for the time of the placing of the wreaths. those of you that are placing the wreaths, I'm going to move this back just a wee little bit. And you guys, as I call your names, will come forward and just start placing them around the grave marker itself. Alright, first we have Daniel Moore of the Charlotte County Grays Camp, 1964. Ricky Pritchett of the Pittsylvania County Vindicators. Diane McMahon of the Anne Eliza Johns Chapter. Darlene Foster of the H. A. Carrington Chapter, 1055. Bill Ray of the Historic Stanton River Foundation. And Kathy Mayhew of the Major General Thomas L. Rosser, Virginia Society of Order of the Confederate Rose. Thank you all very much. Now, we move into the recognition of David Dyer's military service. And we begin that with a rifle salute.
Pigeon Company, shoulder, arm. Tie the colors. Fire by company, ready. Aim, fire. Reload.
Brothers and sisters, what a glorious event, a glorious day to come out and honor our Lord and our Father and honor a brave soldier who was a faithful man and to spend time with his family. Thank you to the family for allowing all of us to share in these moments with you. As we leave here today, and I know that Colonel Dyer would want me to share this with you, your ancestors and mine, as the revival unfolded in the final year of this conflict, they built over 300 churches and chapels in the lines up here between Petersburg and Richmond. And that's something worthy of note, and it lets you know where their heart was. When the chips were down, they turned to the Father. They stayed with the Father. And it's fitting that we will now share in a soldier's prayer. This was removed from the body of a young soldier who was deceased. It's become known as the Confederate prayer, and I'd like to share it with you. I ask God for strength that I might achieve. I was made weak that I might learn humbly to obey. I ask for health that I might do greater things. I was given infirmity that I might do better things. I ask for riches that I might be happy. I was given poverty that I might be wise. I ask for power that I might have the praise of men. I was given weakness that I might feel the need of God. I asked for all things that I might enjoy life. I was given life that I might enjoy all things. I got nothing that I asked for, but everything that I had hoped for. Almost despite myself, my unspoken prayers were answered. I am among all people most richly blessed. Let us pray, brothers and sisters. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thank you for the time you gave us here together, Father. Thank you for allowing us to come together. And as your commandment teaches us to honor thy mother and thy father, today you blessed us and allowed us to honor the father of many here, a brave man, a faithful man. Father, we thank you for this day. And we thank you for the military members who came out here, Father, to make this a special ceremony for us. Thank you for them being here today, Father. We lift up our military, our fire, police, and EMS all around us who bravely are out there to protect us, Father. We ask, would you bless them and bless their families? And as we leave here today, Father, I ask, please bless each person here. Please see them safely home, Father. And I pray that each one has a rich day. And it's in Jesus' name that we pray, and all of God's children said, Amen.